Hello everybody and welcome to more End of the Storm action. Group C, we already had two groups completely played out and we have four teams that advanced to the round of 8 to the final weekend, which by the way is going to take place on the 11th to 13th of September, so definitely mark down that weekend because we're going to have 3 days of Heroes of the Storm action non-stop in the double elimination bracket where we show every single game on stream, so it's going to be pretty amazing. But four teams already qualified for that: Navi, Rocket Team, Liquid and Alternate Fancy. And today's group is a very strong one as well. Group C is featuring not only Spartanian, but we also have Fnatic in here. We have BOB in here and Gamers 2. And our first game of the day is actually going to be Fnatic versus Gamers 2. The team has to play a best of three here. We're going into our first map, which is Cursed Hollow, and we have Tychus in the game. Tychus is being played currently on the side of BOB, and BOB also running this with not only an Uther, but they have also that Mirrodin. So they're threatened right from the beginning of the draft to go into one of those sniper compositions, and then shifted their focus a little bit, adjusted to what Fnatic was doing, and went into a Tychus and a Zagara. Whereas Fnatic is playing this with a Zeratul in this case, and they're also running a Johanna, they're running a Jaina, so a very solid lineup for them too. We have them with an Anubarak in the team as well, and this is going to be quite a bit of fun. Game number one, starting off on Cursed Hollow into our best of three series here to start off Group C at the End of the Storm playoffs. So let's jump right into game number one. Alright everybody, welcome to game number one in the best of three series here at the End of the Storm playoffs. Today we are looking at Group C, and you can already see that we are having a Fnatic going up against BOB in our first game of the day. The winner will end up in the winner's match, and the loser, you already guessed it, will end up in the loser's match. So two teams out of the four team group will advance to the round of 8 of the End of the Storm, which is going to be amazing. We have to the left side Fnatic with Johanna played by Lowell, Kaisel on Jaina, Breeze on Anubarak, will be playing Zeratul here for the team, and Mena on Malfurion. To the right side of the map, it's BOB with Bakery on Uther, Zarmany on Mirrodin, ADRD on Zagara, Snitch on Tychus, the Renegade is back, and Aethero Angel on Tyrael. So yeah, pretty nice setup here. You can already see the new mount, the Malthil's mount that has been acquired by the players reaching level 70 with a season character in Diablo 3. So a lot of players are actually running that. I'm not quite sure if I should actually invest the time to get it, because to be honest with you, I mean, that thing has a bit of a fat ass, don't you think? I mean, I know that it's a lot of armor back there, but it always looks a little bit like Caterpillar when you're looking at it from behind than more like a horse, so it's always a little bit awkward, I don't know. Well, we have already the teams committing to the mid lane, with Wubi and Lowell being here. Up to the top, as you can already see, we have Snitch, Bakery and Zarmany. They're trying to get a lockdown on Breeze to get the first kill in the game. And we are seeing with Seasoned Marksman on the side of Zeratul already a very heavy commitment to especially the later stages of the game when he can have that special... Zeratul actually already trying to attack Zarmany here. I was about to say when he can have that stack process going and when he will finally have some extra damage. Regarding the first talents, just from the first look, we don't really have any big surprises here. Most of the players already committing to talents that allow them or that require them to collect some of the regeneration globes. We can see a double Conjurer's Pursuit, we have a Regeneration Master in here, Seasoned Marksman is going to be important for that. And on the side of BOB, we are seeing ADRD at the bot lane, as is pretty much the norm with Zagara, trying to get the creep tumors out to make sure that he is able to just get the vision, that he also has a very good idea of what's happening here, and of course the regeneration helps quite a bit as well, since he went for reconstitution on level 1, so you have a lot of lane sustain with a build like that. There's not too much happening just now on the map. We have a bit of a roaming going on with Zeratul, just like trying to fight maybe an early opponent that he can take down, but the chances of that happening are slim to none. Zarmany and Bakery, on the other hand, with a double stun against Lowell's Johanna, are trying it. The thing is, though, that with Iron Skin still in play, we have Lowell with always the panic button that he can use to just get away there. So the chances that one of these players just YOLOs in like crazy and overextends are very, very slim. In the mid lane, we have Aethero Angel and Lowell, the two tanks, like, going toe-to-toe, but also now with level 4, already a few changes. So this is one of the things that has been coming into play from more of the Korean scene. We have Even in Death right now, that is basically helpful if you die, and then you can still slow down opponents, or, like, speed your own allies up, and that is definitely helpful in a lot of situations, so you get a bit of a value out of Tyrael when he's dead, and the only thing that you give up for that, in this case, is the reduction on the cooldown on Smite, or if you wanted to go for the safer option, the Amplified Healing, which is actually a pretty big deal. Lowell is also very low here, and the Thera Angel and ADRD take him down. Wubi was trying to help out and maybe get a counter kill, but that didn't really work out the way they planned. So now Bob is ahead with one kill to none, and we are seeing them with the first tribute in the game. Immediately the rotation from Fnatic. Once that Johanna was down, they already knew that nothing was happening. Look at that! Do you see that doubloon? That's the mount that I just bought today as well, and it is amazing. It is so awesome. It's beautiful. It's riding on dirty esports money. That's exactly what you need. So yeah, I'm really liking the mount. Also, as you could see here, just with the radius on the Blizzard, we have Snowstorm taken on level 4 by Jaina, in case that you didn't see that with the talents just yet. Up to the top, it's still Breeze with the experience, but I've been pointing it out already earlier. When Lowell went down, they immediately started to rotate away from the tribute because they realized that they couldn't really take it, and they were just saying, alright boys, let's go for the next one, make sure that we get the experience now, that's all that we need. The problem is that at the upper part of the map, we are seeing a very solid position now for Bob. They captured the watchtower here for vision, so they know exactly from where Fnatic is going to approach, and they're going for the tribute right away. And I think with all of that, nice kill down here against Zagara. We just caught the end of it. But I was just saying, with that tribute spawning at the top again, three heroes at the bot lane, and that watchtower capped out, the chances of Fnatic actually rotating over and trying to take it were pretty slim, and they're just saying, hey, listen up, we're gonna go for the third one, we're just gonna try and push in the bot lane, and then we have to fight for the third tribute, but basically we don't have another chance there. The next tribute is gonna spawn at the bot lane, so they can already start to prepare for that. Up at the top, Breeze is going up against Zharmany and Snitch, as we're seeing Uther rotate to the mid lane, so that Bob is able to put two heroes now to the bottom. And Tyrael actually overextending here, apparently, a little bit. Alright, we'll be moving in together with Kaisel. That was a bit unexpected, that shouldn't have happened there. We have a full Stormbolt build, by the way, on the side of Mirrodin, going not only into the perfect Storm, but then also following it up with the Sledgehammer. And another attempted kill here. ADRD rooted and taken out. Three kills against one. Wubi surviving. Close, but still, he lives. Well done here. Well played. And now, level 8 versus level 8 with a slight leading experience on the side of Fnatic. We have Breeze soaking experience up at the top, but he really needs to start to rotate down to the bot lane if they want to catch that tribute. Both of the teams are now on level 7. We have on level 4, the Melting Point, taken as the talent on Tychus, and we're seeing the sizzling attacks now as well. So yeah, things are going to become pretty heated up down here. We have everybody already committing in the backline. Athero Angel is trying to jump in. Eldruin's Might already cast. And the front line, where Johanna is trying to move back, already using Condemn. Nice, sucking everybody into that Blizzard. Well played here by Lowell and Kaisel, getting that damage in. Breeze is going deep, and he kills Tychus. Tychus, the Renegade, living a life on the edge, and in this case, he dropped off that edge pretty fast. ADRD now also down, and Zharmany is rushing away. Wubi is taken down by Athero Angel, though. So it's currently a 3 versus 3 with Zharmany and the tank line still intact. Maynard takes the tribute, and that's all that Fnatic needs to do for right now. So they are moving away and starting to take experience again on the map. Pretty awesome new start into the game, actually. So we have pretty nice fights there. 3 kills against 5. A lot of kills, actually, this early in the match. And I'm really liking this. This is an extremely important group because we have also Gamers 2 and Spartanian in the same group. So all of these teams are pretty strong and only 2 will be able to advance. We're seeing a commitment towards the camp over there. Level 10 abilities already in play. And there is the Locust Swarm, as there is no melee assassin on the side of Team Bob. They don't necessarily need to go for a Web Blast, which is now called Cocoon. So they go for the Locust Swarm. They have Void Prison, Tranquility, the Water Elemental, and also the Blessed Shield. So quite a bit of stun sustain for Breeze on his Anubarak as well, and that really helps. Sanctification, by the way, was taken out on the side of Bob. We're having them with Commandeer Odin. They are running the Maw. They have a Divine Shield and also the Avatar. I'm really curious about that justification because I really feel sanctification. Sorry, I really feel that sanctification in the last patch was better, and I dislike the current version of it. I still think that judgment is better, and I can see that sanctification has a lot of you have quite a few uses for it, but I'm really not quite sure how much they can actually negate with this. If they get a good one in when Kaisel is trying to use his Blizzard, then they can probably do a whole bunch with it and then negate quite a lot of damage, but let's find out. Already in the back line, wow! Making sure that they can't escape here. The Void Prism in the back, sectioning a few of them off. The Counter Maw immediately being used, but Zagara is in trouble, just barely getting away. No! Gets killed! Zagara taken out. Snitch dashes away, but Wubi is there to finish him off. He himself in the hall. also a fall, but they might get another kill against Zarmany. Yes, no chance for Murder to get away here, and Bakery and also Tyrael are not looking too hot either. Bakery already getting rooted and eliminated, and now it's time for Tyrael to die. Yeah, they kill him too. An entire team wipe, and Fnatic with very solid play here all of a sudden coming in this game, and all of it, like, at the beginning of the match they lose a couple of heroes, and now they come back with a vengeance. They're in a great position, they can go for a boss if they wanted to, and I actually think it's very likely they'll do exactly that. Here they are already committing to it. We're seeing them at the bot lane with a lot of damage there. They killed the entire team, 10 kills against 4 now. But they still have to burst this one down, because this is not an easy fight for them. If suddenly Bob rotates over and Snitch is already on his way, the rest of the team is going to be too late though. And Snitch is very far out, needs to get away, just barely escapes. Zarmany will not commit to it. He has no chance. Tyrael is way too far off, and Zagara was also in the back. So just enough time for Fnatic to get this one. It was a bit of a risky move there still. I mean, it's one of those things that you can do, that you should do. You have to take a risk at some point. But if Bob would have read that properly, if Bob, for example, on level 7 went for Clairvoyance instead of Cleanse, I mean, they need the Cleanse, don't get me wrong, but if they would have any kind of talent that could give them vision and they would have seen that immediately, they could just head it over and contest at the boss right away. For example, a Creep Tumor and Zagara would have done the trick. Now we have the level 13 starting to come in, but Fnatic has a very solid position for the third tribute, and that would curse the opponent. So already the boss putting pressure onto the bot lane, and Bob gives up the tribute. Or do they? Now Zagara starts to rotate over, so they're probably going to try and delay it for as long as they can, but they are down one talent now. Hold Your Ground at level 13 is being used here for Breeze for the increased iron skin. And also with that, the cooldown reduction, if it actually gets taken out. We have at least, well, it's two ice blocks at this point. So they're having two ice blocks that they can use. They have a Burning Rage now as well. And we're seeing on the side of Zeratul, of course, Wormhole, which will allow him to just poke in a lot more. So he can go deep, he can blink in, do a bit of damage, get an auto attack in order to quick cleave and singularity spike and just, like, blink out again. So Fnatic is just playing this. They're playing this as solid as they can now. They know about their advantage. They know what they need to do now. They know that overextending would be a big mistake, that they just have to run with the advantage that they currently have and try to get the most of it. And that's exactly what they're doing. They have a big lead with that extra talent, and they are putting it to use. At the top lane, Lowell soaks experience, makes sure that the wall is taken down. At the bot lane, we're seeing the rest of the team committing as well. Another 20 seconds also on the curse, but they have to be careful because now level 13 is ready for Bob as well, and that allows them to go into Shrink Ray. They have also the imposing will on Tyrael. We're seeing Mutalisk taken on Zagara as the 13 talent with a Thunder... healing static, wow! That is a bit of an odd one. I'm not quite sure if he misclicked on this one, because the icon is exactly the same for both of them, but usually you go for the extra damage against single targets. But Mirrodin, is he really that worried about his sustain that he says, well, I need something to get hit points back, and I can't wait for my stone form on 16? Now that's an interesting one. That could be an accident, but there's also quite a few reasons why you can say that this talent would work here for them, because there's so many closed up spaces where you can jump into your opponent and then keep yourself alive with a quick clap here. So it's an interesting talent choice nonetheless. We're seeing Relentless also on the side of Tychus. Also a strong talent for him. We have at this point level 15 versus level 13. Lowell just double checking that nobody is actually going for the boss up here to the top lane. And the rest of the team was already putting some pressure on the fort and taking it down. So it's now on even talents, a 5 versus 5 fight. And that's exactly the kind of fight that Fnatic doesn't want to take now. They want to stay as solid and as safe as they can, get level 16, and then engage into a battle again. That's the bit part for them. Like, guys, if there's one rule in Heroes of the Storm, it's always the same one. It's like, there's two rules. Don't engage into a 4 versus 5 or 3 versus 4. Only fight when you have even numbers in players. And never, ever take a fight when you're one talent down. Never, ever. If you have to give up an objective, do it. If you have to give up a boss, do it. It doesn't matter. Do not do it. There's very few exceptions where it can actually work out for you. So now with level 16 versus level 14, Bob will not fight. They will not fight. If they have to, if they are forced into a battle somehow, then yes, they will commit to it. But if they have any choice in the matter, they will not fight. If they have to give an objective for it, they will do it. But they cannot fight right now unless they take down a hero on the map. If Wubi, for example, overextends on the Zeratul, and they get a snipe on Wubi and turn it into a 4 versus 5, then they can take Fnatic even though there's a talent advantage for the team in blue. And with that advantage, we are now seeing Fanatism used on level 16. We're having Northern Exposure. There's also double bombs and the hardened focus on good old Malfurion. So pretty strong talents here. No Tenacious Roots, by the way. So Malfurion these days is oftentimes played with Tenacious Roots over Hardened Focus. In this case, though, it's still the reduction on your cooldowns, and that can be very strong. You can see that Bob isn't even going to the tribute. They're not even caring about this. They're like saying, hey, what will we do with the tribute? The only thing that they have to do now is watch that nobody takes boss. So even though they have a talent lead, Fnatic can just simply go for boss and say, like, yeah, we're going to take that right now. That would be overextending still quite a bit, especially if Bob times it perfectly. But they will still loiter around and try to see if they maybe can make something happen here. If they, for example, detect a few heroes on the minimap down at the bot lane that are trying to defend, they could attempt to burst the boss down. For now, Lowell is a little bit split off the rest of the team, but Wubi is now there as well. So with Breeze and the rest of the team, it's just like a very safe play that they have. 10 kills against 4 still. Since we saw that big team wipe, the game has been going in Fnatic's favor, and they've been trying to run that for as long as they could. Lowell, Wubi, Breeze, and Mayna, they are starting to push the wall here. They have in the mid lane now also another Bruiser camp. A few remaining heroes, knights, are still pushing in. But over here, there was decent pressure. One of the towers taken down, the other one nearly destroyed. They also nearly took the wall. But now it's 16 versus 16, and this is the time when Bob is going to fight again. This is exactly the time when Bob is going to say, okay, listen, boys, now we have a chance. We can fight now. Holy Ground on Tyrael. We have Benediction on Uther. There's Stoneform on Mirrodin. Zagara is going to go into the Brood expansion for the double Hunter Killer. They're already setting up position here. And Tychus hasn't taken a talent either, but there it is. It should be Stoneskin. It's one of the best talents that he can take here. But Fnatic still gets a hold of Tribute number 2. They rotated a little bit faster. They were in a good position for it. And there was no way for Bob to really move in unless they really wanted to commit fully to it. And they weren't really willing because they knew what would happen if they lose another big team fight there. So the next Tribute is going to be important for both of the teams. It's going to be super important that you go for this one because it is going to be a cursed Tribute again. Fnatic, I don't really think that they should go for a boss here, not in such a situation. If you are on same talents and the same amount of heroes, going for a boss is very risky, but the lockdown against Zarmony was real, and Snitch forced into Odin, and Fnatic disengages. Now Bob wants to fight, because they just used the heroic ability on Tychus. Yeah, Breeze actually has to go away. Shrink Raid here comes from the back line, the Void Prism. They are trying to suck everybody in. Tranquility already used, and the Blizzards, they do work. Sanctification has been also committed by Tyrael. He gets a Divine Shield. The kill against Zeratul is the first one in the fight, and now all of a sudden it's the turnaround against the Thero Angel. Tyrael is really low, but he might still live. No, he doesn't. He's still trying to apply that bomb, though the Holy Ground is zoning Breeze out, and Mayna, they are getting close enough, but Lowell is already dead, and Kaisel was trying to flank Holy Ground. Perfectly used here by Tyrael. It looks like this fight is going to end in favor of Team Bob. Fnatic is down 2 players. It's a 3 versus 4. They're trying to stall for as long as they can. Kaisel with a bit of additional damage. They have also the position down here with a well, so they can use that. At least Mayna can use it. We could see a few more Moonfires, but there's a 4 versus 3. Mayna is low. The Root is hitting Snitch, though, and they come in from the backline. Great stun here, actually, by Breeze, but no follow-up damage by Kaisel. Didn't have the cooldown ready yet. They are trying to wait. Zeratul is back to business. He can come back in, and he could actually take one of these targets down. Snitch is getting extremely low here. There's a lot of tickling and damage that he is getting, and Kaisel is trying to land another Blizzard. Wubi is on his way. Mayna is there too. It's a 4 versus 5, though, as Ethereal Angel is back to business, and Lowell is still on his way, so he's not in the fight just yet. The Root is being used. Wubi, with a bit of damage, jumps away. By now, the well is down, so they can't use it anymore. Mayna is still extremely low. Another 10 seconds, and yes, Tranquility up again, but it's already too late. The Tribute taken by Bob, and they are starting to pressure now. We have level 18 versus 17, still a lead for Fnatic, but this is going to mean a few structures, and therefore Bob should be able to close that gap in experience right now. They're starting to move in. Ethereal Angel is going to take that creep wave out as well. There's the level 18 for them. 11 kills versus 6. Fnatic in that last fight, they were a little bit too split. They had the right idea there. And again, the Void Prism used, and they go for Zagara. Already Sanctification used. Zagara gets a Divine Shield now as well, as the Void Prism is gone. Snitch is super low. Even with Odin, he's in trouble, and he knows it too. They're all trying to rush away, but Bakery is now dead. Holy Ground was trying to zone them out a little bit longer. They get one kill, not more than that, but that's all that they need for now. At the top lane, there's still a wave pushing in against Fnatic. They need to deal with it. That's also a lot of experience, of course, that they can gather here. And they have to take care of the bot lane as well. But they go for boss first, apparently. Yes, with four heroes, they go for boss. And we have another boss taken up at the top lane as Lowell moves into the top, tries to save this keep at least for now. And he will. The problem is that the boss is probably going to take it down regardless, at least if they cannot protect it with their setup. Now we have the bosses pushing both of the lanes, but this keep down here is also taking a lot of damage. That's of course one of the things that Fnatic just sacrificed. But yeah, solid performance by both of the teams here. Level 19 versus level 19. Already Wubi starting to attack the boss here up at the top using the singularity spikes and everything else that he can use for that. We have down at the bot lane the boss starting to march in against the keep of Bob. They are not so close. Well, they actually just hit level 19. So Fnatic is in a very good position when it comes to the level 20 talent. Another big advantage for Fnatic is that they still have two tributes. So the next one is going to curse Team Bob. Very important here. 12 kills against 6. And now with the level 20 talent, it's going to hit any second, they will have their lead. And that is an important one. So the next tribute should actually end up in their hands, and that would drop the curse onto Bob. The next tribute, well, actually, it might just work out for Bob. It might actually just work out for them. They only have half a level that they have to bridge, and I think that's definitely possible for them. There's the Storm Shield already. It's a talent that's very popular on Johanna right now. Normally, you shouldn't really need to go for Indestructible if you are in a double healer combination, double tank combination, and Storm Shield is great, especially, of course, against all that AoE damage that we're seeing on the side of Bob. They have two of them now, and they also have the Rewind on Zeratul, and we're seeing them with an additional Hardened Shield and a Bolt of the Storm for Jaina and Escape. They already start to deep push the mid lane, and yeah, Fnatic is going to have... They have to fight 20 versus 20 for the Tribute. There's just nothing that they can do about that. The Tribute doesn't spawn yet. There's going to be level 20 any second now for Bob as well. And that puts them on even footing again for the next fight. And there it is already. Redemption used. We have Big Red Button at this point. There's also the first Bolt of the Storm. And when we're talking Muradin, it could either be Rewind or he's just going into a Hardened Shield himself. He has both of these options. And they are amazing. And he is going into Rewind. That means now double Storm Bolt for him. And he has Perfect Storm, so he was trying to build up some additional damage. That's not going to be too tricky when it comes to hero damage. I mean, like an extra 200 damage or something is not going to be the end of the world. But it's going to be the damage against structures thanks to the Sledgehammer combination that is going to be extremely important. Nice zoning here for Main, a very nice zoning. Alone Baneling was trying to make its way over, but that doesn't happen. Here's the curse, Fnatic with a great position that they took here. Nice Void Prison in the backline, that's perfect! Doesn't get any better than this, but we had Holy Ground also used, Sanctification now in play. We are Tranquility is keeping Fnatic alive and they are able to disengage here. But that was a perfect Void Prison in the backline there. Ethereal Angel with the Holy Ground was able to zone them out a bit and keep the two of them alive. But that doesn't get any better than that. Good sectioning off of two heroes of Fnatic here now too though. And that could turn things around again. In the middle of things, the Gaara with the damage, Ice Block on Mana being used. Breeze is about to drop and he dies. The curse for Fnatic, but one of their heroes is down for another 60 seconds. Now that's tricky. We're currently having the mid lane with Kesil and Mena. They all move back and, yeah, well, with that one kill, they basically guaranteed themselves that they're not going to lose a keep. They shouldn't lose one. It's a 4 versus 5 for another 40 seconds. That curse only lasts another 10. So that curse was basically negated by this one kill happening. And that was very cool play. That was very well done, actually. I'm liking this. It was a very solid situation on their side. And, well, let's see how they're going to play it from here on out. I mean, at this point, we need to see Fnatic with some kind of play, because they are also falling behind in experience. That's not a big deal at this point. I mean, it's a stat advantage that you gain if you had a level over your opponent, and that's a flat-out damage and also a hit point boost, but it's not a massive one. It's not something where you say, like, alright, that puts us over the edge where we can win the team fight over our opponent now. But it's still going to matter at some point. So, right now, we have another camp stolen away, and Fnatic is starting to play this a bit more passive. 12 kills versus 7 overall in the match. Looking at the damage, in case you're interested in the numbers here, especially the healing numbers, of course, are now also of interest. 47,000 against 38,000. Zagara died the most, which is the case usually. We have also 3 deaths on Zeratul. None on, none on Malfiorin and not a single kill against Jaina either. So the only two heroes in the game that haven't died yet on the side of Fnatic. Well played by them. And yeah, for now it's just like the bosses are going to be up when? In another 20 seconds. So yeah, it's probably going to be a fight over the bosses. The next two tributes are not going to be too important for the teams because, well, it's only going to be tribute number one and tribute number two. So it's not like you are running into another curse, but the bosses are going to be really important. It could be that they're just trading them. They could just be trading. One takes the top, the other one the bot. But we have already one keep lost, as you can see on the map. So this keep was destroyed a little bit earlier. And those minion waves were just pushing in together with those siege giants. And that puts now Bob into an advantageous position. They have a little bit more experience, which, as I said before, doesn't really matter too much anymore after you hit level 20. But despite the fact that they lost more heroes in the game, they are now in this situation. Breeze and his boys, they have to commit to the boss, because up at the top, we're already seeing Bob doing the exact same thing. Are they contesting? Yes, they are. They're trying to contest, and that's the other option that they have, but they need to do it fast. Whoopi has the Void Prison. They are moving in and down to the bot lane. There's Tyrael. Ethereal Angel thought that there would be a counter attempt, but that's not happening. Here comes immediately the Void Prison. They're jumping in, and they get the kill against Zagara. They take down also with a bit of luck. Zarman, you know he jumps away, but Bakery goes down, and the boss gets stolen. Ethereal Angel wasn't with the team. They thought that Fnatic would go for their own boss, and Ethereal Angel with the Holy Ground taken on level 16 can potentially steal the boss, or at least threaten, and now Bakery dies for the second time, and he's now down for good. So Fnatic all of a sudden has that chance that they were waiting for. 15 kills against 7. They take the keep, and how much more can they achieve now? They wait for the boss, and they're going to try and finish the game. With the boss barreling down the top lane, all 5 of them still alive, they can now move in, and that's exactly what they do. Bob got a bit too greedy. They split Ethereal Angel off. They tried to take the boss with 4 and expected Fnatic to move to the boss at the bot lane. It didn't happen, and now it's time for Fnatic to shine. They move in against their core, and just like that, they are now in a position where they can take the 1-0 lead in this best of 3 series. Great play by Fnatic. GG, and Fnatic leads with a 1-0 in the first best of 3 series at the end of the Storm playoff group C. Bit of a miscalculation there at the end of the game for Bob, and it costs them the map. They actually thought that Fnatic would go to the bot lane to claim their own boss, and they sent Tyrael over there to kind of screw with them a little bit and try to steal that boss away with Holy Ground on level 16. But Fnatic instead went to the top lane in the 4 versus 5 situation. Bob couldn't really claim their boss. They tried though, lost too many heroes, and Fnatic wins the game. But a very cool back and forth match that we saw on the first map. And game number 2 is taking place on Tomb of the Spider Queen. We see Fnatic actually committing to an Asmodan composition, also with a Kerrigan in their midst. They're once again going straight for an Anub'arak, and they have in their case also the Johanna at the front line. Whereas on the other hand, Bob is playing a very different setup, playing the double mage setup here. With a Jaina, a Kel'Thas, they have a Karazim for the heals, and they're having at their front line not only Mirrodin, but also Arthur. So pretty sick combos here, actually. We have the Song of Ice and Fire, if you so want, for Bob. They are playing both of the mages, and Karazim, the monk, we've seen him sometimes as a solo healer for teams, especially in the European scene, and Bob, they really, really like the hero, especially Bakery, their support player, is a big fan of the hero, and we are going to check out how he can actually perform in this particular game now against Fnatic, because they need to win 2 in a row now. If they really want to go to that winner's match in Group C, they have to take 2 games in a row, and let's find out together if they can actually pull that off, or if Fnatic takes a 2-0 against Bob and advances to the winner's match. Alright boys, and girls of course, especially hey to the girls. I mean, if we have a couple of female viewers, then yeah, big shoutouts to you. Currently, we have our second game in the End of the Storm Group C, our first best of 3 series of the day with Fnatic and Bob fighting it out here. And Fnatic actually has the lead, and we have a great game ahead of us on Tomb of the Spider Queen. I'm loving this because the draft is amazing. To the left side of the map, we see Lowell on Anub'arak, Kaezil on Asmodan, and well, Uther is being played by Mena here. We have Breeze on Johanna, and Wubby on Kerrigan. So Asmodan together with the Kerrigan going up against Bob's Karazim played by Bakery. Zarmani's playing Arthas, Snitch on Kel'Thas. We have ADRD on Jaina and Ethereal Angel on Mirrodin. So a very sick setup here for them. I'm actually liking this quite a bit. So first of all, of course, it's all about the taste for blood here for Asmodan. I mean, that has been Asbrodan's big thing for a long, long time now. And of course, he got a bit of a facelift in the last patch. Doesn't make him really any prettier because, let's face it, he is an ugly bastard. But he is a very fun ugly bastard and he's very strong as well. So we're gonna see him with the stacking process here. And the Kerrigan is always gonna threaten to jump in. But I have to admit that I like both of these lineups like quite a lot. Oh, there we go already. I've told you guys over and over again that Asmodan shouldn't really teamfight at the beginning of the game, right? That he should always try and use those Globes of Annihilation to just take down minions. Well, if you have the minion wave just on top of a few heroes, because Kerrigan pulls the heroes and then you can do both. It's a win-win situation. It's awesome. So, well, right now we have Main and Wubi up at the top lane. Asmodan is just doing his things as usual, and I'm really liking it. Once again, moving in straight away, and here we go. They burst it away. They give Asmodan the stacks, but they are also losing Breeze, and that's a problem. Breeze down means that Johanna is lost to them for a bit longer, and therefore, of course, the stacking process of Kaecil is a bit slowed down. We have Karazim going straight into Transcendence on level 1, as was to be expected. I mean, you go for the heal. What else really is there? Of course, Johanna is now coming back with a Night Takes Pawn, but also a bit of additional damage used on the side of, well, Asmodan, at least for now. Breeze is waiting for the cooldown to be ready. Well, they can't take this wave. They should have an easy time taking it. Asmodan is going to get his stacks in. We're going to talk about his process in just a bit. But for now, let's look a little bit on what exactly the opponent's team is doing. We have Zarmany on Arthas and, of course, the Thero Angel and Mirrodin. So a very heavy front line here with also a lot of lockdown thanks to Zarmany. And the thing is, if you lock a target down with one of the two tanks, or even better, with both of the tanks just following up their stuns, the cool thing here is really that you have with Jaina and with Kel'Thas a very aggressive backline that can put so much pressure on a single target with flame strikes, with living bombs, with a blizzard, that it's super strong to really take those down. So it's a very cool setup for both of the teams here. Kerrigan has to be a bit careful up to the point where then she's going to hit her shield talents. I don't really think that in this case Wubi would not go for the shield talents. He kind of has to. I mean, at least on 13 and 16, he needs to make sure that he gets a bit of additional sustain. That's the only way how he can do that. Army of Hell now used on level 4 here, so that the Demon Warriors can do a bit more. That actually allows Asmodan to push quite a bit, and you can still see that especially Fnatic and Kaecil here in particular are experimenting a bit with the Asmodan build now that the hero got changed. The last time that we saw them play the hero on the map, they went into that Envenom variation that he has on level 4. But in this case, it's now Boundless Conviction. We have pretty normal build so far with the Protective Shield on the side of Karazim, the Monk up at the top, played by Bakery, of course. It's the Thunderclap build played by Mirrodin in this case, and that of course helps especially against heroes like, let's say, for example, Kerrigan. Against Kerrigan, it's pretty strong, can help you. Could have gone for a Stormbolt build, I suppose, with the setup that we're seeing here. Now, also having now an Arcane Intellect talent taken a level 4 for Jaina, so mana is not going to be an issue for her. And, Kaecil and Breeze still very, very slow here. Getting their hits in, punished to finish the job. And even using Iron Skin now to negate the damage on the Living Bomb. Up to the top lane, Zarmany is trying to push it back. So it's a pretty slow pace at the beginning of the game. We saw a few aggressive moves resulting in actually a kill. Maybe we're going to see another one. Nah, Mane is going to get away here. Actually, he gets locked down, but a 3-for-1 is not really what he wants to fight. Bot lane was pressured as well. And we are now 4 minutes in. Time to... Oh, actually, another good hit here by Asmodan. Let's see how many stacks he has. So Asmodan at this point is at, 98 stacks already. So nearly 100 that Kaecil has. And 4 minutes in, that is actually very solid. That's a pretty solid move here. They are just about to hit level 7. We are way, miles away from a potential level 10. So when he has the Black Pool, and all that you need with Black Pool is 80 stacks so that you can eliminate an entire minion wave without any help whatsoever. And yeah, so far that's actually quite solid. That wave they screwed a little bit up. They didn't really get too many here. But now Zarmany is the one pressured, and he gets lasered into the ground. All shall burn being used, and Asbrodan gets the kill in here with the rest of his team. Well done. Both of the teams on level 7 now, and that gives us the Echo of Heaven. Also, interesting that we're having with the... a nice hit against AD already. Oh my god, that was close. They could have potentially taken him down here. And they do! Mana goes in, and with Boundless Conviction and the increased length, he's able to get it in and take him out. Well done here. Great job here taking Jaina down like this. And now the Blue Webweaver is descending for the first time. And that is amazing. If with Asmodan you're able to establish the first objective for yourself and take down a few structures, you find yourself in the great spot. Normally the Asmodan composition is the one that is a bit weaker at the beginning of the game. Of course, Kel'Thas is going to hit a bit of a power spike on level 13 when he gets his chain bomb. But so far, Fnatic is doing a great job here with this composition that they're running. And it will allow Asmodan to get more stacks in, since the more lane presence you have, the more map control you have, the easier it is for Asmodan to really get those Globes of Annihilations in. He doesn't have to contribute to teamfights. It's one of those big rules. There, people ask oftentimes, should I start fighting with my team as an Asmodan at level 10 when I have my Black Pool? And the answer is always, you shouldn't. If you can avoid it, you should not fight. You should try to delay it for as long as you can, because every Globe of Annihilation that you commit to a team fight is a minion wave that you do not kill. And that's of course another like potentially 10, 12 damage points that you do not get. In this case, they are able to get a kill in also against Jaina right now. Very solid performance here now. 4 kills against 1, very well played. And in this case, this is just an amazing start into the match on the side of Fnatic, and they are playing really well here. So we have them with the first Webweaver wave, taking down a lot of the hit points on the fort at the bot lane. The entire wall was destroyed in the mid lane. It's probably also going to fall eventually. We have Breeze helping out Asmodan even more, soon to be on level 10. And I mean, with level 10, we are going to see, of course, the Black Pool taken. And that's going to happen right now. So now that we have, well, Blessed Shield, we have a Maelstrom, as you can see, to the left side. There's a Divine Shield. Again, the Locust Swarm and the aggression in the mid lane. Kaecil, is he going to go for another hit? Globe not used yet, but he can, and he does. But he misses. AD already moves down to dodge the globe, but he moves into 4 heroes and dies. Asmodan at this point, to double check his stack process again, he's currently at 162 bonus damage. So 172 at this point. So still alright. Could have had a bit more, I suppose, but they were really busy killing a few heroes along the road as well, and therefore he's a little bit lower than he could be at this point. But he now has Black Pool, and that allows him easily to take down these waves. He has more than enough stacks for that. So a very solid process here by Fnatic. But still, Bob is holding on to this. They are starting to fall behind in experience, but they have that big power spike later on level 13. We already know that. They are currently in control of 74 gems. We're seeing them with the Divine Palm, with the Army of the Dead. They have also Phoenix used. There's an Avatar and the water elemental that they're running right now. Down to the bot lane, we have an attempted gank against Lol and Wubby. Kerrigan! Yeah, okay, they move back at least for now. Okay, so quite well done here. We have currently the attempt to jump in again. Kerrigan already on the way, locking down Kel'Thas. Divine Palm used and helping out Snitch, keeping him alive. He uses Phoenix and the Divine Shield, saving a Nuborak's bony ass just in the last second. Well played here by Mbaina, and actually Mbaina was really low in mana as well. So Asmodan is just roaming the map again. They take down, or they try to take down a few of the structures here. He gets a pretty good hit in, not only against the minion wave, but also dropping Snitch to roughly half HP, more than that. And at the top lane, they also get even more structures. So a very solid experience lead now for Fnatic, and very nice moves here for Asmodan to get the extra damage in on his Globe of Annihilation, which is exactly what they're doing right now. 12 to 11, that's currently what we're seeing in regards to talents. Lol pushing the bot lane now could potentially also put more pressure onto the fort. He's not going to take it down with the Thero moving in, but still a solid position for them. The problem that Fnatic has is that if they can't kill a hero that carries a lot of these gems for Bob, then they will have to deal with a lot of Webweaver waves eventually. The good thing for them is that by then, Kaecil should have enough damage on his Globe of Annihilation for Asmodan that he can really help out and push those back, and that's exactly what they are going to try and do now. But this is the opportunity that Bob needed to come back into the game and close that gap in experience. Another big hit up at the top, but this time without the Black Pool, and that does not really allow them to take the wave down, so that didn't really help too much. We're currently seeing Lol and Aether Angel at the bot lane, still having that little dance against each other. But in the mid lane, Zarmany gets locked down, but the Water Elemental is already trying to turn things around. Divine Shield keeping Wubby alive. Mena once again with absolute brilliant play here. A couple of really clutch Divine Shields that he threw out thus far. And he's doing a great job. We have the, well, there's the Phoenix already, also threatening in this case the well. And that makes it a bit difficult for the teams to actually stay in here. Lockdown attempt against ADRD, and they are about to burst her away. Divine Palm being used. Bakery with good play once again. Wubby jumping in again. God knows why. That didn't work out. I'm not quite sure if he could have escaped there, but it was more likely to happen than just jumping in again. Maybe he thought he could deliver a kill, but now they lose two heroes, and that is all the momentum that Bob needed. And with the talents now on level 13, we have now finally also the chain bomb, and oh my god. Breeze and Mena get taken out. That did not work at all for them. Engaging into that fight didn't really pan out. Now they are losing the fort up here in the mid lane. The Webweaver is still pushing, and we're seeing the same happening at the bot lane where the fort was already destroyed. So now all of a sudden, we have, with one simple move, BOB taking an entire level lead, 13 versus 13, and here they are. They're going into the shield talents on Kerrigan, as already predicted. They kind of have to with the setup that we are seeing run here. And we also have a double spell shield, and that is just an absolutely must-have talent when you're going up against the J and the Kalthus. So BOB is back. They are back and back with a vengeance. We're having, in the case of Kerrigan, by the way, pretty much a standard build with level 1 going for the energizing grasp, which can be pretty nice for the sustain that you have to get a bit of mana back, and this is pretty strong since mana problems is one of the things that Kerrigan oftentimes has. There are a few alternatives that you can go for, but in this case Wubi decided to have some more lane sustain. And with the first talent here on level 13, he also increases the duration of his shield that allows him to carry it from fight to fight. We're having both of the teams now heading straight into the middle there. Also, against Kerrigan and Johanna, they're seeing a double Relentless taken now on Arthas and also on Karazim to make sure that they're not getting stunned too much. No, Snitch gets nearly taken out, but Wubi, can he close that gap? Wubi gets blown to pieces, and Bakery actually saves Kalthus, but then there comes the dunk, and Asmodan hits him full in the face. So yeah, still a level lead on the side of BOB. They hit that level 13, and then they start to turn things around. That's their power spike that they have. We haven't checked Asmodan's stacks in quite a while, so check that out again. We're currently seeing him at 308 damage, so quite solid potential that he has now in those fights. But he's still working on it, of course. So it's 6 kills versus 7. And BOB has taken out 3 of the forts. And now also moves in with another Webweaver wave that is already making its way over. So a very tricky situation now for Fnatic to be in, since they are now down on a talent 2. They have level 13 versus level 16 talents. Not really something that you want to fight. We're seeing on level 16, Circle of Light for additional heals for Karazim. Stone Skin, Arcane Barrier, great talents, great sustained talents in particular on the side of BOB now. It's interesting that we do not have a single spell shield taken by BOB. It's only one frost armor, ice block that they use in this case on the side of Jaina to have some survivability against Asmodan, but everything else very much disrespecting the Globe of Annihilation and more respecting the Kerrigan with those stuns. So the boys have to defend up at the top, and Asmodan is currently in the mid lane dealing with a Webweaver here, pushing that back and eliminating that quite easily, also getting a few more stacks in the process, of course. Up at the top lane, Lowell is getting a lot of damage here, but he should be able to get away without any problems. That Phoenix, on the other hand, is going to put a lot of pressure onto that keep, and it looks like BOB might actually be able to take this one out. So they are trying to move in with a poke that they have. Ah, nice attempt here by Kerrigan to take one of the heroes down, but a pretty cool AWP here also from Kaesil. Gets a 4 or 5 man AWP there, and that does a lot of damage. He's getting pretty serious about that. They need level 16 though, and they need it fast. They need that extra talent on Kerrigan so that she gets double shields. They need to make sure that they're getting also, of course, a few more moves on with especially heroes like Uther for Benediction, for the extra heal on... They were trying to go... Nice move by BOB, look at that. They go straight in for a sneak at the keep. At the camp. Very well done here. Kind of read that perfectly. Another red Webweaver wave. That's what I've been talking about earlier. If they get those Webweavers over and over turned in again because of all the gems that they were able to hold on, then they're in a decent spot. But Fnatic, for them, it was really more of a problem of losing all of the heroes up at the top lane when they were trying to defend the fort, because that's really where all went south. Now they have to defend at the bot lane. Yeah, 16 versus 16. We're seeing the extra sustain. Oh, Divine Shield and carry again. But now the Divine Shield's over. They're jumping against her. Went in Wubi with a lot of damage. Also, again, the Globe of Annihilation doing some work. We have a double blood for blood in this case, and the kill against the Nuburak. Fnatic losing another hero here, and it looks very much like BOB is going to get their first keep in this case now, and probably more than that, because the mid lane is now threatened to the top lane. We've been talking about it, is very low here, and there's another Webweaver marching towards it. Level 18 versus level 16. Great comeback here on the side of BOB. Very well played, and the game's definitely not over, and we've seen actually Fnatic with some crazy comebacks on this map in particular with Asmodan, but they really need to make some plays. They need to get some kills, and if they are not able to push them back, then it's just lights out for them. They lost two of their structures already. Bob is looking for boss, but it's more trap than anything else. They have 55 additional gems right now, and Breeze is already moving in, using the shield glare. Alright, identifying what's going on. The Globe of Annihilation is also out, meaning that it's currently in cooldown. Very nice move here on the side of Johanna, moving back in the last second with an iron skin, making sure that also that Netherwind doesn't really hit. Again, the hits in the backline, but this time Kaecil misses, and they lose Kerrigan again. Kerrigan a bit too far out in this case. The two tanks already gone. Lowell and Breeze are trying to keep themselves alive. Oh, yes, Iron Skin up again. And the Divine Shield is just there to help them out. So Breeze moves away. Nothing really that, at least for now, Bob could achieve. But they are on level 19. A solid two-level lead for them now. And they are in a perfect position to hit that level 20 first. Looking at Asmodan again and his stacks, he's currently looking at 440 stacks. So he's very, very strong when it comes to the Global Annihilation damage, but that's not all. They need more than that. And up here, there's already another threat against Breeze and Mena. It was a good globe. If they would have followed, that would have hit for sure. We have by now also Kerrigan back to business, so it's a 5 versus 5 again. But Fnatic, I mean, they have to do something now. They really have to start doing something. Of course, Asmodan is going to get his extra damage in. We have also pretty sick damage numbers here. If you look at the siege damage, 150,000 on Asmodan, 51,000 hero damage. That's extremely good. The heal, on the other hand, nearly 60,000 heal on the side of Karazim. And we're seeing Uther only with 22,000. It just shows again how strong Karazim is with the heals if you let him live, if you don't lock him down. So, very, very strong here. At this point, we have, by the way, Kalthas with 31,000 damage. So, living bombs are strong, but still. Kal'Arthas, for example, has more. He has more hero damage. So, in this case, I'm curious to see what the next level is going to bring Bob, because they are looking at level 20 in a few seconds. And Fnatic has only one more fort, or one more keep in the mid lane. So, therefore, this is the last stand that they have. They need to win a fight now, and they're trying to put that in. They're jumping on Kal'Thas as much as they can. The Divine Shield already used. We have Kerrigan in the middle of things with the Divine Shield, locking everybody down as much as she can. But the damage against Jaina, and especially Karazim, is real bakery. Trying to rush away. The kill against Jaina with good Global Annihilation, but already the kill against Anubarak. 1-for-1, and it is Kerrigan again who goes down next. Uther follows a second lane. The level 20 talents are finally there. Breeze was moving in. Snitch never died, and now they're trying to follow up with another kill against Kaecil. Very well played here by Bob once again. They get their kills in. 12 kills against 7 now, and this is going to be game. They are able to tie this series. We're going to see a third game. Now Johanna is dead as well, and with this we have, of course, a core that gets taken out. Very well played here by Bob, a great comeback by them, and they will force Fnatic into game number 3 here at the end of the Storm playoffs in Group C. Great play, and GG. The series is tied. Bob makes it possible. They take the game against Fnatic. A pretty cool game that they played here, actually. At the beginning, it really looked like Fnatic would be able to, maybe not dominate, but at least get a very good foothold in the match. They got the stacking process going for Asmodan. They got the first few Webweavers, even they secured themselves a couple of wins. But then later on, especially Bakery coming through with Karazim here and using that Divine Palm over and over again to save heroes. There was no Web Blast on Anubarak to really lock him down with a Cocoon. So in this case, Bakery just coming through for the team, healing them up, getting incredible numbers out there, and the Divine Palm in particular really helping his mates out. So in this case, Fnatic loses the match, and we are going into Dragonshire now, our final map of the best of three series, to find out which team is going to claim it. And we have a bit of a surprise. Bob drafted Chen. It was not a mistake, it actually happened. Leoric and Chen on the side of Bob at the front line, and they are running as their damage dealers again, Kal'Thas and Jaina. So for Fnatic, we have a completely different setup this time. But especially that Chen in the game is, of course, one of these things where you're just like, oh my god, mind blown. We have Fnatic with a commitment to a Tyrande here again, and they're running with a lot of heroes that can really lock a target down. Anubarak is one of their favorite ones these days, and they're also having an Arthas now for a potential Howling Blast into stun. Tyrande, of course, throwing the Hunter's Mark in, and then them trying to deliver additional damage. But let's see how Chen is actually going to work out now for Bob, because this game is the game that really counts. Which team will win here and enter the winner's match, and which team will lose and drop down into the loser's match at the end of the Storm playoffs? Alright everybody, it's time for the Panda, game number 3 in the best of 3 series here at Group C of the End of the Storm playoffs. And to the left side we have Fnatic now on the final map against BOB, with Lowell on Anubarak, Mena again on Uther, he's a beast on Uther. We have Breeze on Arthas, Vubi on Zagara, and Kessel on Tyranda. To the right side of the map, Bakery on Karazim, ADRD on Jaina, Zarmany on Leoric, Snitch on Kel'Thas, and Aethero Angel on Chen. Yeah, that was no misclick. Yes, you definitely see the right hero there. It is a Chen, and he goes for Regeneration Master on level 1. We already have the Owl with a good hit against Snitch here. This is like how a shitty game starts. You're just walking out of your gate, and then all of a sudden there's an Owl to the face. And that's where you know, okay, this game is going to be annoying. Up at the top, we have Lowell, Breeze, and Kessel currently waiting. These three heroes can really lock a target down. They have a lot of stuns there available to them. We're also seeing them down in the mid lane here. And which mount does he actually run? He runs that ugly... Mena on the money pick is making fun of Aethero's Panda mount here. Yeah, well, I have to admit that that crocodile thingy is looking pretty ugly. So yeah, Breeze already. Breeze. Missing this one. And the stun is missing as well. The jukes. He's juking all of them out. He's eating a lot of damage, but still, that was well done here on the side of Aethero Angel. So, in terms of talents, we have Transcendence taken again on level 1. Talking to my Kodo. The shit talk is real. Okay, we're not dissing players or anything. No, we're dissing mounts. So, we have an additional attempt to take one of the heroes down. But yeah, it's a rotation between the mid lane and the bot lane, for BOB at least. At the bot lane, we're seeing Bubi. Chen is currently claiming the top. And, well, we have Aethero Angel going up against Anubarak in this case. A lot of Conjurer's Pursuits, 2 in total. We have also 2 Regeneration Masters. There's a block on Arthas. Could theoretically also go into Regeneration Master with him. Wubi already fighting against Karazim. Karazim has so much sustain, it's really silly. Like, in the early game, it's so difficult to really take him down. I mean, he can't commit to any fight on the map there. But still, like, you always think, okay, I'm going to be good against him. And then all of a sudden, like, he gets another fist attack in and heals himself again, and you're just like, wow, really, did that just happen? Am I just losing to a support? So he can be quite annoying. And I'm really wondering if Lowell on his Anubarak is going to go for the Web Blast for the Cocoon in this game to make sure that that Divine Palm is not screwing them again, because on the last map, Divine Palm saved like a bunch of teamfights for BOB. So maybe we're going to see an adjustment in the build. Mena is going straight for the Boundless Conviction on level 4 again, which, by the way, in the last game secured a kill, in case that you forgot. He was able to take one hero out with it that would have gotten away. Bakery now pausing the game, gives us a chance to talk a bit about the talents here. And I want to talk about this level 4 talent, Locust Needles. I've been talking about it in the past, right? I mean, the spines on level 7 are a really great talent when it comes to additional AoE damage, and you can burst down waves with it quite easily. Locust Needles is, if you want to take it to an extreme, the first team that actually did it in the past was, if I'm not mistaken, Elysium Black, one of the Greek teams, and they did very well with it. They used it on a different map, though. They used it on Blackheart's Bay and were using Anubarak to just solely claiming the top and the mid lane, just roaming between the two of them, bursting the waves away, getting the experience, and just like keeping the team in the game like that, where the rest of the team committed to the bot lane. So in this case, it's of course a different map, therefore a bit of a different playstyle, but the idea is pretty much the same. In teamfights, you can do more AoE damage, and also, of course, on the lane as well. So, yeah, already there we are, back to business, the unpause. We're having with the level 1 talents, and a healing ward on Tyranda. Tyranda with a healing ward there on level 4, and other talents are pretty much the same, pretty much common. I don't think that we should actually see for ADRD the Snowstorm on level 4. He hasn't committed to his talent yet, but there it is. He went for a Conjurer's Pursuit, so he doesn't need Arcane Intellect on level 4. Has already enough mana regeneration, especially in the later stages of the game. Another pause here, apparently BOB with a few troubles. So at the top lane, we have 3 heroes committing to the tower. You can see there's no rotation right now. So that is a bit of a problem. Snitch and Bakery are starting to rotate over, but Leoric is very much alone at the top. Wubi has a problem with all of the pressure at the bot lane at the same time, though, because there's now a Siege Giant camp that is pushing in against us as well. We have up at the top lane only Zarmany, so he's going to lose another tower, and that's going to happen right now. But the bot lane will be pressured quite a bit as well, and that is going to become an issue. So they take two towers, they take a lead in experience, they have a very solid position there, but at the bot lane we now have a Theora Angel against Wubby, and he is tanking a lot of that damage that can be dished out by the Hydralisk by simply just hitting that bottle. So we need someone to rotate down, and that is in this case Arthas together with Kaisel and Taranda, and already scouted out by Snitch, so he knows what's on, and therefore he can just simply move away. So a pretty cool early game already, very solid performance here by the two teams fighting for the shrines, making sure that they have all of that in. We're seeing in the bot lane still these rotations happening, and it's really important that you still catch all of the experience. That's why we're having Mena always in the mid lane, trying to soak the experience there. But that's also one of the reasons why he is in the mid lane, because it allows him to just rotate over and help out if one of the lanes needs a healer. Kaisel down here is eating a lot of damage, and both of the shrines... Oh! Great move by Snitch! Netherwind being used on level 4 here, gets the Gravity Lapse in, and that puts Fnatic in an awkward position where they have to try and use the Boundless Conviction for Mena to capture the Dragonite statue. The bot lane is being attacked, level 7 for both of the teams at the same time. Breeze is back to business and moves in against... Yeah, nice! Hits the Owl now too, and the cooldown on Mena's Boundless Conviction should actually be ready, so he should be in a position where he can use it again to just cancel the channel, and he does that. But now Breeze needs to... that was so close. Nobody is able to catch these shrines. Wubby actually is super low right now, nearly dying here in the mid lane. Still, the fight's happening, but it's 3v2 now. So either somebody from BOB has to rotate over, or they are not going to be able to take this one. On level 7, we have the Echo of Heaven taken after Amplified Healing, which of course has a great synergy with the Regeneration Master. We have now Brewmaster's Balance, and they're jumping in again, and this time they're going to get Snitch, but they are also losing Uther. He can, of course, heal still a little bit longer, and Breeze will have a very easy time against Bakery here on his Arthas, so they're still trying to make sure that nobody is able to get the Dragonite statue, but it is a lot of pressure against Fnatic right now, and that has to definitely like screw them a little bit. It's really difficult, and ADRD gets stunned out, so they're doing a great job by keeping the Dragonite, but it's too late. It's too late. This time BOB is able to lock it down. They have the Dragonite now, and they move into the mid lane with it. At the bot lane, we have Wubby up against Ethereal Angel, so he has trouble on Zagara against Chen here. Chen has just too much sustain. Zagara is not able to get enough damage in. The only thing that the Panda has to do is hit that keg again, and then he's good to go. Having in the mid lane, still the two healers fighting each other and claiming experience. And this is one of those very important lessons that you can take from the pro games. If you have a Dragonite against you on Dragonshire, do not commit all of your heroes to one lane. Always make sure that you soak the other lanes, rotate through the dragon lane with two of the heroes. Two heroes rotate to the dragon lane and try to go for the deep push, but you always keep heroes on each lane so that you can soak experience. You will fall behind. Depending on when exactly that Dragonite statue is captured, you will lose a few, but at the beginning of the match you always want to make sure that you still have the heartbeat on the lanes. That is usually true until level 10, sometimes even a little bit longer, but until level 10 you really want to make sure that you're not rotating with everybody. Later on in the game you have to commit to 5-man moves on the map, but at the beginning this is definitely very, very important, and it's exactly what we just saw here. Nice attack here also at the bot lane, but as already mentioned, one of the things that Chen has definitely going for him is that 6 sustain. We're having the level 10 abilities now taken, and that means Divine Palm. This time it is Cocoon, it is Web Blast that has been used by Anubarak, so therefore he will be able to interrupt the, the Karazim heroic ability, or he should be able to time that so that Karazim can't heal target. We're also, of course, seeing the Wandering Keg right now, which is pretty much the standard talent on the side of Chen. We've seen a few. Have you actually seen Storm, Earth, and Fire? I don't really think we've seen it for quite some time. Water Elemental, March of the Black King, and also Phoenix used. The top lane rotation against Leoric. They were trying to lock him down before he uses the Wraith Warp, but they're a bit too late. But Zarmany, uses the March of the Black King to make sure that he gets away there. Pretty smart move by him. I actually like that. Heroic abilities with the Syndra Ghost, Starfall, a lot of slow and lockdown during the fights for Fnatic. They are still behind in the game. They actually have lost an entire level on their opponents. The rotations are again going towards the bot lane, as we have ADRD now joining up with the rest of the team. Only Leoric is still doing his own thing. But we see Mena and Kaisel jumping in now. One stun, the second one, Water Elemental already used. It's a 4v3 still. Not quite sure why they are committing here yet. They have no Anubarak, he's still up at the top. And Anubarak, as I said before, has a lot of pushing power now. He has committed to the level 4 AoE talent and the level 7 AoE talent, and therefore he can burst these waves away, which is exactly what he does. It allows him to pressure Leoric back, or at least to counteract Leoric's lane push, and it also allows him to just be at the top lane and put pressure on the fort itself, so that, yeah, Bob has to react and do something about it. Lockdown again against Ethereal Angel. This time they might actually get him. He's trying to jump away, and he has to use the Wandering Keck to roll away using the Heroic. So that means that the bottom shrine is going to end up in the hands of Fnatic for now. Level 13 talents are going to be active very soon. We have Zarmany up at the top. By now, Lowell rotated into the mid lane. He's already pushing this one back, but he makes sure that he is with the rest of the team so that they can not only control the bot lane shrine, but also push one of these lanes in. The problem is, of course, that Zarmany is completely happy of pushing in at the top fort and take that. So they have to either rotate against him and send somebody top, or just push one of these lanes enough so that they can counterbalance that. And right now, they're not able to do that. So again, up at the top lane, Lowell captures one of the shrines. We're seeing now Kaisel and Mena moving Zarmany back. The bot lane, on the other hand, that's where Wubi has to use his Maw. He's trying to escape, but he might not be able to get slowed down and taken out. Zagara dead, and that gives, of course, Bob even more lane control. Snitch with a bit of damage against Breeze after the gravity lapse here, but he doesn't have enough to really lock him down. The top lane with Lowell and Zarmany. So far, Lowell should actually be able to do quite some damage here. The problem is always the Drain Hope, of course. That's when Lowell has to move back. Against the Drain Hope, you have no chance in this case. So we have now also with the level 13 talent, Crushing Hope taken. ADR going for the Dragonite again. The Owl misses. Wouldn't have made a difference, though, because, well, at the second grasp, we would have seen ADRD take that Dragonite either way. Level 13 versus level 10 talents, and these talents are super important now on the side of Bob. They push Fnatic back, and Fnatic is now starting to struggle. Here comes Syndragosa, trying to lock them down. Doesn't hit anything, by the way, so that didn't really work out for them. Here comes the Starfall in play. Level 13 talents are now finally ready. No Web Blast in time. We still see the Divine Palm on the side of Kalthas. Wandering Keck is trying to isolate one of the heroes, and they're pushing Mena back. Mena is being pressured in, uses the Divine Shield to keep himself alive. They're trying to supply some damage to zone out for him, but yeah, well, that didn't work. So in this case, they're losing another hero. Four kills against one. Bob with a very controlled game here. They play this really well. They have Chen and also Karazim with Relentless, so all that lockdown that we're seeing for Fnatic is pretty much useless against them. That negates a lot of the potential pressure that can be executed by Anubarak, Uther, Arthas, and also Tyranda. Very great play here by them. And especially that Tyranda pick just didn't really work out for Fnatic yet. Personally, I'm not really a massive fan of Tyranda. Oh, that was a nice hit. Kaisel hitting three here. I personally like Tyranda a lot more when you have a Jaina on the same team, because you have that burst damage that you really need to burst the target down. In this case, they unfortunately for them don't have that. They're seeing another pressure play here by Ethereal Angel by stealing those two Siege Giants. He could use the Wandering Keck. No, he can't. He's still in cooldown, but he has some friends rotating over, and that's all that he needs. And it's level 16 versus 14. That's an additional talent again with the Circle of Life. Another great healing talent for Karazim. Numbing Blast, Divine Shield once more on Kaisel. He's trying to ride away on his money pick, but that's not enough. No, wow, no Arcane Barrier, but instead the backdraft taken for Kalthas. Okay, so now even the slow that we're seeing for him, he feels confident enough to say, I do not need that shield. It's a great shield and it's awesome, but I don't really need it because, well, they don't pressure me either way. I'm not afraid of anything here. That Chen is enough to use his, yeah, his Wandering Keck to barrel them away if they really go for me. So I can really go for that extra slow, and that's what they're doing here. They have the renewed swing now as well. No talent that really combos off with it, so no synergy. They could have gone on level 7 for, well, Paralyzing Rage, for example. Then the renewed swing is even better. Or they could have gone for Consumed Vitality on level 16 instead of renewed swing. But it helps also Leoric to get these waves down even faster. If he moves in, he can go for a double swing, and then any wave is immediately eliminated. 16 versus 13 talents, and apparently Fnatic feels pressured enough that they move in with this and try to get that Dragonite. Lowell, oh, here comes already Breeze with Syndragosa, but they are extremely low at this point. Oh, and they're pushing Kaisel back, or at least they're trying to. They're going straight for Tyranda, but the Dragonite is going to be captured by Leoric, and Zagara is dead, and Ethereal Angel gets saved by the Divine Palm. They take down Mena, or they're at least close to. Mena is somehow locked down here. Apparently he couldn't move out of this. This is a little bit weird. Maybe a bit of a pathing problem, but I don't think he would have been able to live either way. So complete control in the game now for BOB. They play extremely well right now. We're seeing Zamini, Bakery, Snitch, and AD already moving in, making sure that this keep is going to fall. The top lane is pushed by one of the Bruiser camps. At the bot lane, we're seeing a Siege Giant camp already target down the towers here. It's currently a 5-3 on the map, and the situation is just absolutely devastating for Fnatic. They're trying, they're really trying to do what they can, but right now it looks like BOB is going to have a pretty easy second keep here. They have another 28 seconds on the Dragonite, and together with the Siege Giants, they put so much pressure onto this. Another lockdown attempt against LoL, they move him away, and you can really tell how much Backdraft is screwing with Fnatic right now, slowing everybody down. Divine Shield already used in this case now to save Kaisil, but Breeze is getting locked down, and there comes the Nether Wind to finish him off. Well done. They're also seeing now the keep down at the bot lane eliminated, and this is two keeps that they were just able to take on. They might even try and go for Core. Well, I don't really think so. A level 16 is too close for Fnatic. They have already two keeps taken. They're close to 20. Why risk it? I don't really think that they have to. They don't really need to risk anything here, and at this point they're actually still going for the keep at the top lane, saying, alright, we can take this now. But it's 16 versus 16 now. The problem is really that with all of those living bombs that we have going around and the backdraft, it's a very... it's a huge amount of control that you get if you get those bombs off. It's not only the damage, but the control that you get as well. If you are able to go into backdraft and you don't have to go for Arcane Barrier, you will find yourself in an amazing position during teamfights. Now we are also seeing the Peaceful Repose, which is crazy good, because even if you miss the Divine Palm, you still have the cooldown ready. They're trying... Look at that barrel! Oh my god, like the Ferrari under the Wandering Kex. Very well played here. Jumping in right away, job well done with level 60. Well, we have him with the untapped potential. Level 16, he went for pressure point. Kel'Thas is dead, and this is game as BOB takes down the Core and wins the series against Fnatic with a 2-1. Very well played here. Congratulations to BOB. Panda power, BOB takes it with a 2-1. They lose the first game, they lose on Cursed Hollow, and then they win two games in a row on Tomb of the Spider Queen and on Dragonshire, and claim a 2-1 victory here against Fnatic. They find themselves in the winner's match where they will face Gamers 2 next. Great play by BOB, and they are so close now to qualify for the round of 8 of the End of the Storm, for the End of the Storm finals. Fnatic, on the other hand, they drop down into the loser's match where they have to face Spartania next. Of course, they still have a chance to qualify, but they will have to fight very hard for this one. One more loss in the best of three series, and they are out completely. Great play, on the other hand, by BOB, and especially that Chen pick was, of course, amazing. Really enjoyed casting the series. BOB always showing new heroes. They showed Karazim now twice. They showed Chen as well. I really hope that you enjoyed the series as well, and of course, not only the games, but also the commentary. If you did, make sure that you give the video a thumbs up on YouTube. Subscribe to YouTube if you haven't done that just yet. Hit that sub button on Khaldor TV. And guys, I'm going to see you soon with more End of the Storm. We're going to, of course, have also the winners match here on the channel with BOB up against Gamers 2. That's going to be a very interesting one as well. So make sure that you check out the channel again, and I'm going to see you in the near future. It was a pleasure casting for you today. I hope that you enjoyed it. I'm going to see you next time. Have a good one, and bye-bye.